where that world championship goes, we're going to be the kings. We're going to reign supreme. You can count on it.
Well, we'll find out beginning tonight in Columbus, Ohio, at the Ohio Center.
He's undefeated in a Russian chain match, and Paul Orndorff may have made one of the biggest mistakes of his career.
He may have indeed, and we see Koloff in the ring now getting ready. He always brings the chain to the ring with him. He's going up against right now a very fleet-footed competitor, Mike Jackson, and Jackson ducking away, using his speed and agility to move around. So Jackson finally meets him head-on and gets the side headlock on Koloff. Hip-lock takedown. Koloff trying to turn that to his own advantage. Jackson keeping the side headlock. There's where Koloff has that power, and Jackson hanging on those ring ropes. Now Koloff closing in again. And again, of course, we still have that situation with that knee of Koloff, and I realize that nobody has for a fact found anything in that knee or that knee pad. And yet, like you, beautiful leapfrog by Jackson, and Jackson caught him with a good drop kick. Jackson on his man, moving against Koloff, has him into a hip lock takedown, into a side headlock. Jackson moving very effectively. Koloff breaking it up again, and of course, you felt firsthand that knee.
Well, Gordon, you know, like you said, nobody has actually confirmed that there is something in the knee, but you know, as we saw on the tape, I believe last week, we saw the man do something to his knee pad, and then he hit that corner post with his knee. Now, if you're going to go on and hit one of those steel corner posts with your knee, you're going to wind up with a fractured kneecap, something like this. I can't say what he has in the knee. All I know is there's something more than a knee and a knee pad in there, Gordon. I felt it firsthand. Paul Orndorff felt it, and I can't say what's in it, but there's definitely more than just a knee in there, Gordon.
Well, there you have it from a man who's experienced it. Jackson in a high backdrop by Ivan Koloff, the Russian Bear. Koloff. I tell you what, though, he's got a double tough youngster in Mike Jackson. Mike is a tremendous young pro athlete, and Jackson, not afraid to go to the air, gets him in a flying head scissors, takes Koloff to the mat. And Koloff may be learning a few things himself, Tom.
Well, Mike Jackson is no doubt. He's a tremendous competitor, and he's one of those guys that gets in there. He's going to give 110% no matter how big these guys are. And Ivan Koloff is finding that out for sure. But again, this is a problem. But Mike Jackson seems to be doing a very, very good job.
He is indeed, and he has kept Koloff as much on the defense as he has been on the offense. So Jackson has been taking the fight to Koloff. Jackson may have gotten a broken nose. I'm not sure. He took a smash right to the nose. I don't see any traces of bleeding, but a couple of times Jackson has gone back to that nose. It may be that he's getting a little bit of a breathing problem.
Well, it may look like it hurt him, but when you're in that match and you're sweating, you won't really know the extent of the damage until you get back to the dressing room and you're sitting down. Maybe you take your shower, and a little bit later that pain will start coming, or the swelling will start coming. And you're right, it looks like Mike may have a little bit of trouble breathing right now, but I don't think that's going to stop him by trying to get a Koloff like he did right there.
Precisely. Beautiful headstand escape, and it's Jackson exploding on Koloff now. Jackson sets his man. High backdrop, and Koloff is down, came down on his hip, and may have some problems here. Jackson trying for the pinfall. Koloff able to power away from it, and that time Koloff caught him with a knee. There's that knee again. I didn't see him adjusted or anything, but brother, he caught him with that knee.
No, Gordon, I didn't see him adjust anything either that time, but he has big legs. This is a big man, Ivan Koloff, and any time that that knee comes down on you, it's going to do damage.
Jackson outside the ring on that concrete and having his problems trying to get it together. Being warned by the referee and backing up, the count has started. And Jackson very, very slowly coming up. And that last backdrop took it out of him. He was up and ready for his man that time. reverse, and Koloff again breaks it up. Brother, I'll tell you, Jackson keeps after him. He keeps trying for that pinfall.
Mike Jackson has that determination. He's not going to just lay down for the man. He's gonna fight him. He's going to let him know he's in there. He's going to give him everything he can. His size doesn't intimidate him. He's going to go in against Koloff, but, Paul Orndorff is going to come at him, I think, in a different little way, and Koloff had better be ready for that.
He had better be indeed. And it is Jackson that time caught by Koloff. Koloff dominating the situation, and Jackson trying to get it together as Koloff continues to be on top of him, and Jackson, who has taken the very best that Koloff has to offer. In a one-on-one situation, I would say that Mike Jackson has acquitted himself extremely well. However, I would venture to say, if Koloff had been able to go into this match with a Russian chain, and I would venture to say that the results would have been much quicker and much more disastrous, because this man Koloff, as Tom has pointed out to us, is undefeated in the Russian chain matches. Jackson fires back as Koloff staggered, catches him again, and Koloff a wild swing that missed. And Jackson, there's Koloff, back to the basics again. Back leg sweep with his right leg and has Jackson back to the canvas. Referee Scrappy McGowan warning him. And I'll tell you what, time is running down. Jackson might, I don't know that he can get a pin, although he could. It's only a three count. But if he can hold Koloff to a draw, he will have certainly accomplished quite a bit. Jackson, charged Koloff, and Koloff ducked to one side. Jackson could have jammed his shoulder.
Well, you know, anytime you run in full force into that turnbuckle like that, it's a dangerous thing to do. But Mike, get it in the excitement and in the heat of battle, the heat of things like that, he rushed in a little too soon, and you're right, he could have jammed that shoulder in there. But he's still fighting. He's still coming back. He's still on Koloff.
He is carrying the battle to Koloff, but Koloff ahead of him that time. Arm whipped off the ropes, and it is good reversal by Jackson that time. Koloff caught in the backdrop, and it's Jackson. Ooh, brother. Koloff again the knees, and so much of what Koloff does seems to depend upon his knees. Koloff again driving the knees to the midsection of Mike Jackson, steadily taking, and Jackson trying to move away from that corner, caught by Koloff, driven to the canvas. It is all over. It is all over for Mike Jackson and Ivan Koloff, of course, who wants that National Heavyweight Championship that is currently held by Paul Orndorff.
Hey, Buck, you know, he's already finagling himself into getting me into a cage match. Tell me what it is. Is it a loser's league town? No, I want to know if it's a loser's league town. It's got to be something. He already got on national TV and embarrassed me.
Find out next week along with everybody else. And right now, we have a very, very special word. Great wrestling champion, Ric Flair. And again, let me welcome you back.
Again with Mr. Pritchard. I didn't mean to walk out here and cut you off. But what I have to say, I think, will be of some interest to you, as I'm sure it will to Gordon and all the wrestling fans throughout the world. You know, I am a professional wrestler by choice. I take a lot of pride in being a professional wrestler. I wrestled in high school. I wrestled in college, and I paid the dues through training and hard work and a lot of dedication to get where I am today, just as Tom Pritchard has paid the dues to get where he is. And athletes involved with World Championship Wrestling right here, Georgia Championship Wrestling, Mid-Atlantic Championship Wrestling from the Carolinas, the Mid-Atlantic area with Jim Crockett, Mid-South Sports from the Mid-South, Southwest Sports Incorporated, World Class Wrestling, Championship Wrestling from Florida, the top organizations of professional wrestling. The list goes on. The point I'm trying to make is a lot of guys around the country today think that all you got to do is buy a pair of wrestling boots and buy a pair of trunks, and all of a sudden you're a professional wrestler. and that you can go around and advertise yourself as a professional wrestler. You can promote a wrestling show in some town somewhere, and all of a sudden, they're seeing championship wrestling. Well, Gordon, you know, as I know, it takes a lot of money to wear custom-made clothes. It takes a lot of money to be one of the top athletes in the world. And you don't get that by doing anything other than competing on a championship level with a championship organization. So, ladies and gentlemen, what I'm trying to say to sum this up very briefly now is that anything you see that's not associated with the wrestling you see on television, please believe me, has nothing to do with National Wrestling Alliance or Ric Flair, who is the World Heavyweight Champion. Now, we all take a lot of pride in being great athletes and great wrestlers. The point I'm trying to make, I'm sure you understand, this is wrestling at its best. And anybody out there that wants to be a professional wrestler or calls himself a professional wrestler, I'm sure you can come down here and on any level wrestle with some of the gentlemen here. We'd be glad to give them an indoctrination to real championship wrestling.
Interesting point by the NWA World Heavyweight Champion Ric Flair. We're going to be taking a look at one of the great international stars right now. I'm referring, of course, to the great Kabuki. He is from Japan and an exceptionally dangerous man in the ring. I'm sure Tom Pritchard will attest to that as well. And Tom, I'm going to ask to bear with me on this one and lend some of his expert commentary because Kabuki is a great one for using karate and judo-like thrusts and blows.
Well, Gordon, you know, like I said, I trained in karate starting at 10 years old, and I started teaching karate myself when I was 18, but my first love was professional wrestling. Now, when I'm in the ring, I always profess that I wanted to wrestle. I wanted to be known as a good wrestler. Now, someone like Kabuki, he uses more the martial arts than he does his wrestling. The man has a tremendous amateur background in wrestling, I understand, but his martial arts outshine everything he does in the ring. As opposed to wrestling. I enjoy wrestling. I enjoy getting in holds, doing the counters, whereas this man, he prefers more or less, such as this hold here, a nerve hold, getting his man down, working on his man when he's on the mat, such as this. But otherwise, he enjoys using the kicks, the thrust kicks, the punches, the spinning back kicks, and things like this. I'll use them in the ring, Gordon. I don't mind using them on occasion, but at times I would prefer to wrestle. Now, this man right here, such as that, he'll use a kick to the knee, which is very dangerous to your joints, such as this, but it's very effective.
Certainly no question about that, and it becomes pretty obvious, too, with this particular maneuver that Kabuki has perfected, that the knees, the ligaments, and the cartilage in the knees are put to a tremendous strain, and you can tell the pain that's coursing through this man's body right now. There you see Gary Hart, his manager, and speaking about managers, again, you have another presence that is felt anytime you see Kabuki. You're going to see Gary Hart, who perhaps is the most evil of all of the wrestling managers that I know of. J.J. Dillon, perhaps at the moment the most successful. However, Sonny King does have in his possession right now the national tag team champions of the Samoans. How long they remain champions, well, that is an interesting point, too. Kabuki, again, as you said, using the thrust kick and has this man in an awful lot of trouble.
You know, Kabuki uses that thrust sidekick very, very effectively. Now, if you watch this coming off the ropes, beautiful sidekick to the back of the back of the back in there, and it looks like it. This is where Kabuki's strength is, his karate, his martial arts powers, and this is where I think his success has come from, Gordon. And he's Gary Hart has himself a man that knows how to use the martial arts in a very capable way.
Bo Sawyer going out against Zane Smith. We saw Zane Smith a little while ago in a videotape match that took place some time ago against the great Kabuki, and Zane is a gutty young competitor. And
Let the man up, Sawyer.
There's only one way, of course, as we've talked about it before, Tom. There's only one way that a baseball player is going to become proficient in his sport, or a football player proficient in his, or a wrestler to become proficient in his, and that's by experience. Unfortunately, sometimes in getting that experience, you take a lot of lumps in the process, such as Zane Smith is just taking.
Well, Gordon, any time, like you said, when you start out, they're going to throw contracts at you. They're going to see how much guts you have, how much you're going to take, how much you really want in this sport, how much you really want to get in there and give it your all. And they're going to put a contract in front of you and say, here, you want to wrestle this guy, sign it. And you either say yes or no, or you say no, you take your papers and you walk. And if you want to make it in professional wrestling, that's what you have to do, Gordon. Like you said before, it takes a lot of dedication. You just can't put on a pair of tights, get in there, and expect to make it overnight. It takes a lot of dedication, a lot of hard work, and this is what it's all about.
Certainly no question about that, and Zane Smith is certainly finding it out. Of course, he's facing a man that was in the Nationals. He's been competing since he was 4 years old, and he is, I think, too, somewhat unnerved by everything that's happened with Hacksaw Butch Reed, and is beginning to take it out on anybody and everybody around him. And a stern warning here from the referee. Charlie Smith laying some words on Sawyer, and it takes that. Sometimes I think Sawyer needs to be hit between the head, hit between the eyes of the 2x4 to get his attention.
Well, that's right, Gordon. You know, Buzz Sawyer is one of those kind of guys that he likes to hurt it. He likes to rub it in. He's a very aggressive competitor. And
we just saw it there with a belly-to-back suplex and high neck bridge. Let's take a look at this. Here he is underneath the center of gravity, but not. He was a little bit high on that. However, watch him now as he bridges up, drives Smith's shoulders into the mat for the count of three. Belly to back suplex, well executed. And
well executed wrestling, Daddy. We're talking about the two greatest wrestlers in the world. You know, this Paul Orndorff, this Reed comes out there, Tommy Rich, they talk about the war, this Pritchard here, they've all gotten together, and they say, this is right, the Omni, Marietta, Gainesville, Honeyville, Columbus, on tour, we're looking forward to the day started. He comes out to the lead, and he punches Mad Dog in the jaw. He got me in that cage, he manipulated himself, he's the man that got me in the Omni. On Christmas night, when I just might have something for you, Reed, because you don't stand nowhere in my body, brother. And when Cola is done the board off, wrapping that chain around his neck.
Take it in, because I always remember a man that is upset.
What's he got in that box? What has he got in his sister?
Under just what he's going to do. And he had a big board of directors meeting, which numbers three people, of which two are his Samoans. And I'll just kind of give you a little insight. The reason that they don't wear shoes is because they have a hard time telling the difference between which is a left foot and which is a right foot. So at the end of 3 weeks, Sonny King says, hey, J.J. Dillon, the $30,000 that you won at the 7th Annual Tag Team Tournament, if you'll consider putting that up, then I'll put the national tag team belts on the line to go against your Moondogs. Well, Sonny King, get those belts polished up because, Daddy, I'm on the way. Because that $30,000 to me is not much of a gamble. Because the way I see it, Sonny, that's a $30,000 investment. And
going pretty well your own way. You were moving along very successfully. And, well, suddenly things changed. But it was not because of your opponent in the ring. It was because of, very frankly, what was happening outside the ring.
You know, I just was tending to my match. You know, I thought that's the only thing I had to worry about. That's, you know, trying to beat my opponent there. And then just out of the blue, here comes Koloff and Bud.
Now that Between the two of them, obviously, here, you had just finished a tough match. Between the two of them, they got you tied up in the ring ropes, and this is Buzz Sawyer with a pair of clippers and trying to take all the hair on your head, and took a pretty healthy patch as it was. And that has to be a pretty doggone humiliating situation.
That's right, Gordon. You know, it's not the amount he cut off that matters. It's just, you know, it still hadn't grown out. It looked a little funny. All, you know, some of my friends and everything, you know, would make jokes.
I've heard Pritchard out here talking. I've heard Johnny Rich out here talking. And I've heard your biased opinion out here, too. Let me tell you something. Nobody's going to run Sawyer off. Nobody's going to embarrass Sawyer. And I'd just like to see what's in this box right
here. If you open it, sir, you'll be suspended, and you know that.
Let me tell you what, Mr. Sawyer, I'm sick and tired of people like him and like everyone else trying to run Buzz Sawyer's life. I'm here to stay, and I'll be around for a long, long time.
Well, maybe he won't, maybe he will. I don't know. All I know is that we're going to, before this hour is over, we're going to be opening this particular package, and we are indeed going to find out. Buzz Sawyer is going into a match right now, going up against Bill Smith, one fall, with a 10-minute time limit. And I see Ole Anderson watching things with a reasonable amount of interest.
Can't imagine that everybody is going to think that anybody can do, like Reed, can do something to Buzz Sawyer to embarrass him. I see Reed's out here. He's all excited about it. Pritchard's a little excited about it. The knees are shaking. I tell you, it's going to take a lot of doing to get Buzz Sawyer embarrassed. And you're just not going to be able to say, Buzz Sawyer, lay down for a few seconds. You're not going to be able to say, well, get out of town. You're going to have to make him do something. I don't know anybody that can do that.
Well, that's an interesting point. You know, I don't know whether it's the holiday season or whether it's this particular box or what, but I've noticed we have quite a few people returning here to this particular area, talking about the Super Destroyer, the Superstar, Andre the Giant, your tag team partner, Stan Hansen. We've got a lot of people coming back.
Listen, everybody else can come back, but Stan Hansen, you know, when you mention that name, just kind of gets me a little upset. He cost me $25,000 in a tournament here that I had to forego in the Omni. When was it? Thanksgiving?
Well, wait, wait, what do you mean? $25,000?
Yes, $25,000 is what it cost me because that guy wasn't there. So I had a forfeit. It was what?
It was a $50,000 tournament, $30,000 to the winning team. If he wasn't there and you had to forfeit, that'd be 15 apiece, wouldn't it?
Well, no, it wouldn't, Gordon, because I was going to get 25 if we won, and he was going to get 5. You don't think that he is equal to me, do you? You know, he's big and he's strong. He doesn't have too many brains. You know, they just told me I had to have a partner, so I just got myself a piece of meat, and that's what Hansen is, a piece of meat with two eyes. There's no way in the world that Hansen could think any farther than his nose. I got to drag him around. Every time we went, I said, come on, Stan. I almost had to dress him. You think he was going to get an equal split on that money? Stan Hansen cost me $25,000. And for that, Stan Hansen go rot wherever he wants to rot. I couldn't care less about him.
Well, I am. Well, I'm floored by.
I don't care for Hansen. I don't care for Rich. I don't care for Hacksaw Reed. Not crazy about you sometimes. I don't think it's necessary for me to like all these people. And when you talk about Hansen, any dime that somebody causes me to lose money, 25,000 big ones, well, that gets me a little bit warm.
Wow, you act like you could buy him off for a glazed donut or something, sir, and I just don't think that's quite right. Stan Hansen is pretty big, a pretty tough man with a heck of a reputation behind him.
Well, I won't worry about it. I want some people to know right now that when this match takes place, Mr. Reed or Sawyer, I want people to know where I'm going to be. Look at that. Look at that.
Beautiful move.
There's a man for you. There's a man for you.
Beautiful move. I can't deny that. I cannot deny that at all. Buzz Sawyer, a beautiful belly-to-back suplex into a high neck bridge, scored the pinfall and did it with certainly, well, we'll get a chance to see it again in slow motion. Look at this. Deep down underneath this man, good low center of gravity, underneath the center of gravity, had that body like a tripod, brought him back from the waist lift into a high neck bridge, scored the pinfall. Brother, you cannot deny.
Still, I'm not done with you.
No, because like Tommy Rich found out, we're getting burned. It's just a start, Paul Onda, you stupid American. You signed contract with Russian chain match. This, I never lost in this type of match. It's going to give me great pleasure in beating you to death and taking that national title away from you.
Well, we're going to find out, obviously, December 25th at the Omni here in Atlanta. Tickets are available, of course, at all seats locations and at the Omni itself. May I suggest you call? It's going to be a tremendously spectacular night of wrestling. Don't forget Buzz Sawyer against Hacksaw Butch Reed.
It's solely these people out here talking about the Omni Christmas night. They're talking about saving my head. Well, first of all, Reed, you got to beat me. And second of all, you got to remember those shears and those scissors are going to be laying around. So I'm just slow to grab them myself and shave your greasy head.
Boy, I've heard desperation in my time, but that man is full of it right now.
Even Buzz Sawyer's head, you better remember, you're going to have to beat the guy first. Well, what happens, Reed, if you get beat? What happens if you're laying on your backside? I'm going to be right there. I'm going to be watching every move. I'm going to be right outside that cage. Anything goes wrong, Reed, you make one bad move. Rich, you and the other cousin, I'll be standing right there, and I'll be watching everything. I guarantee you when you get done, somebody's head's going to be shaved, but it ain't going to be Sawyer. Reed, we're going to send you packing bald and maybe Rich in a bargain.
All right, one fall. Television time remaining now. Mike Jackson and McKenzie going up against Ivan Koloff and the Iron Sheik. And Jackson has his hands full already, but watch out for Jackson, brother. Koloff missed as Jackson moved in on Jackson, catches him with a beautiful drop kick. The Iron Sheik comes in and Jackson catches him as well. And you talk about a firebrand. This Mike Jackson is exactly that.
Well, Mike Jackson, I don't think he cares how big the guys are or not. He's going to come at you full force and straight ahead on.
Let me say something.
Sonny King has joined us.
You guys get out here. Bruce Reed brings the box out, and now he gets out here, and you and Tommy Rich, Johnny Rich, Bruce Reed, you as well, Pritchett, of all people. And God, I thought, you know, I had respect for you. You know, you saw Ancient Away a little bit at a time. Do you think for 5 minutes that Buzz Sawyer is going to step in the ring any place at all, and he hasn't got friends? Well, look, Bruce Reed may have you, Tom Pritchett, and the rest of these people, but that doesn't mean one iota. You know as well as I do, Pritchett, Buzz Sawyer is a true man. His plans for Reed are just the opposite. He gets out here and he pounds it with words, but in the ring, it's all action. Now, let's say something about Ondorf. Paul Ondorf, the All-American boy, the champion, who we all say, they do it to Brandon Bull from Florida, doesn't mean one iota. Ivan Koloff and everybody in the world championship viewing area knows by now, Ivan Koloff have chased Paul Orndorff, and he have said to Paul Orndorff, Orndorff, this is what it's about. What do you want to do about it? Orndorff run around. He puts his title up against everybody. But against Ivan, it's a little bit different. So then Ivan drew up a deal for him and made a good deal with him and said, okay, we'll go one-on-one. I'll do it your way and you do it my way. Orndorff is going to have to do it Ivan way. Then when we come back and talk to you the next time, it will be a different story. And the complaint will be, just like always, those people. Tommy
I find
Rich.
It very interesting. Just a moment, Mr. King. I find it very interesting. We've talked about Orndorff. We talked about Buzz Sawyer. I don't notice you saying a word about your national tag team champions.
It's all in the bag, man. It's all in the bag. It's just a matter of time. I mean, you know, Dillard runs his mouth. I don't have to run my mouth. I came out here, I proved myself. I am still a champion. That's all I can say. I don't have anything else to say. Nothing else to say about it. Tommy Rich, he's got a debt to pay with the Sheik. Rich is really going on thin ice, Garden. On thin, thin ice. And then I'll prove it to you. It's just a matter of time.
Now, oh, very, very interesting. Mr. Dillon has agreed to put up 30,000. Ooh, McKenzie caught right at the belt line by the Iron Sheik, who drove that foot in there. Gut-wrench salto, well executed by the Sheik. And that's the thing about the Sheik. Having wrestled for Iran in the Olympics, he has such a vast background. His skill and his knowledge in wrestling is so vast that he becomes one of the most formidable opponents I've ever seen.
No doubt about it, Gordon. But, you know, I can hear Mr. King talking, and I can hear him talk confidently. But you know, it doesn't have that same ring. If you may have confidence that he did before, it may sound like his Samoans, and maybe his arm shake may be a little bit in trouble, Gordon, in the Omni.
Well, it could be.
You know, God, let me just say something. World's Championship Wrestling is going on a tour. They are carrying one of the heaviest cards around that they've ever carried around. This is going to be the talk of wrestling. You know, Garden, they got wrestling in every place that we go, and it's just people. But they are really people. When you go watch this wrestling, Garden, it's like watching your kid play Sandlot football when we're going out and watch a pro team. The pros is going to travel. World Championship Wrestling is taking the top pro wrestlers in the world on tour. On tour, Garden, and I'm telling you, and my ring is still the same, Tom. I haven't backed off of anything. My ring is still the same. I says I'm champion. I got nothing else to talk about. I'm champion. I'm on top. I have nothing else to talk about. I'm talking about people that you people say is the greatest in the world. You know, you say they're greatest in the world. You said Bruce Reed is going to do this. Bruce Reed is going to do that. Bruce Reed is going to cut Sawyer's hair. Bruce Reed is going to do that. Tommy Rich is going to help him. They're going to. Why in the world is all of us? But Sawyer got friends. But Sawyer got friends.
Yeah, Ole Anderson made that.
We got lots of friends. Lots of friends.
Yeah,
lots of friends. Darn, let me tell you, the dressing room that we come out of is not afraid of anybody. And the people know that. When one of our guys get in trouble, we all walk out and take a look at it. You know why? Because we're not afraid of anybody in no place at any time because we don't have to. We are true representatives of the professional wrestling world on my side of the dressing room. Believe me, I'll tell you.
Okay, Koloff coming down across the midsection of McKenzie. Catches him again, and that's about 250 pounds coming down across that abdominal wall. And a backbreaker there. He got the count. He got the count. And that really came as no great surprise as Koloff wrestling out there, certainly with renewed vigor, and so is the Iron Sheik. And of course, both of these men obviously have things that they want to prove.
Gordon, I can't believe what I just witnessed on this thing. Ole, I stood by you, boy, when everybody in the world turned their back on you. I stood by you, and you repay me with this. Well, let me tell you something, boy. You say you're going to be hanging around ringside, being sure, and might even shave somebody's head, Buzz Sawyer's head, or this Hacksaw Reed's hair. Well, let me tell you something, brother. I'm going to be there, too. And I'm going to be there, too, for one reason, to watch you, Ole Anderson. And if you make one move towards that ring, I'm going to show you what this lariat's all about. And maybe I might even shave your head. He needs a lawman from Texas, and there's nobody better than me. A man from Texas. They call me the lawman. I'm going to be on the tour, brother. Get ready, Ole Anderson. I'm going to be watching.
Action in Columbus, Ohio. The beautiful
Russian Bear moving out against John King. One fall, 10-minute time limit. Koloff, an enraged individual. He does not like the accusations that have been hurled about the fact that he uses something in that knee. Good reversal by King, and as King charged, Koloff caught him. And, brother, I'll tell you something. Hey, this King is beginning to move rather effectively. A good block by Koloff, and that's the thing you've got to be so careful with Koloff. He is a ring veteran.
No doubt about it. You know, I think Koloff may have other things on his mind right now. One, Paul Orndorff. And that might have caused him just a little bit slip up earlier in the match, but right now it looks like he's got a composure back, and he's doing a little quite a lot better. And I'm sure Koloff, though, he has to have his mind on Paul Orndorff. It's got to take a lot out of you, knowing that you're going to be strapped to a man with 8 foot of chain, and there's really no place to go with that, you know.
Except to the City of Pain, my friend. The City of Pain is where it's going to be coming from. Referee Charlie Smith checking once again. Koloff was not choking, and it is King firing just under the rib cage, trying to break loose if he can. An overhook by Koloff. Koloff now takes him back into the turnbuckle. Has his man really completely under control. Koloff, high backdrop now on King. King back to the canvas. Koloff keeps himself in absolutely tremendous condition. Yeah. King hurtled from the ring. And is slow coming up. Koloff is right out there after him. A boot into the midsection by Ivan Koloff. And King has been slammed onto the concrete once again. Koloff back inside. And a man who is completely dominating the situation, King. Gamely trying to come back to his feet. Gamely climbing back, crawling back into that ring. And Koloff after him. Hurdles him out the other side. And I'm beginning to totally agree with you. I think that all he has on his mind right now is Paul Orndorff, the national heavyweight champion.
Well, I think Paul Orndorff might be in the wings watching this match, too. I'm sure he's going to watch every move Koloff makes. He knows he has a very tough man. You know, Ivan Koloff's undefeated in these chain matches. And I think Ivan wants to remain undefeated in these chain matches. And he wants to make sure Paul Orndorff has no way to get out. And maybe possibly damage his career, damage his body in any way he can.
Brother, Mr. King is getting plenty of damage to himself right now as Koloff completely dominating him. And King trying to get it together. Koloff climbs up behind him. And here's where he just drives that knee into the mid of the back of King, has him down for the pinfall. It is all over. And you'll see another example of what we're talking about as... Wait a minute! Wait a minute! Paul Orndorff just exploded on the scene. And Orndorff just ran Koloff off. Brother! Paul Orndorff in a Russian chain match, and of course, the Iron Sheik faces Tommy Wildfire Rich.
Sheik, when I told you before about Tommy Rich,
yes,
okay,
sir.
You didn't do it the way I said to do it. If you would have done it the way I said to do it, Tommy Rich wouldn't be any more problem. Now he's a problem with you. Do it the way I said do it, and Tommy won't be a problem.
Mr. King, I promise to you, and I promise to all Iranian people, this time I'm going to do your way.
Okay, Mr. Koloff.
Last time matches, Columbus, Huntington, Cincinnati, the Omni. Paul Orndorff, I cannot wait. Richard J. Matt, I've taken the national title.
We're talking about Cincinnati. We're talking about Dayton. We're talking about Huntington, Columbus. Everybody is so privileged to have Buzz Sawyer to see him in person. And I'm coming hard and I'm coming strong. And just like the man says, always on my mind, Richard Reed, I'm coming strong. You know, once I walk into Huntington, West Virginia, then I'm going strong on down to Columbus. Then I'm going big time. Cincinnati, Daddy. We're talking tornado matches. We're talking hard times. You out here, Mr. Sully. I hear you say the word pain. Hey, I live with pain, baby. You know me from Cincinnati. Every time you see me, you people get on your knees, and you know that you got the best in the world right there. And you know yourself, Mr. Sully, when I stand here in front of you, and we're talking Christmas night, baby. We're talking shaving Butch Reed's head, and we're talking about the best in the world right here in Living Color.
Buzz Sawyer moving out against Randy Barber. And Sawyer is a picture of a totally, completely aggressive man. I don't care what sport he would be in. His personality, his drive is the kind that is totally offensive at all times. And frankly, sometimes his personality is offensive as well.
I think you're right, Gordon. You know, he's the kind of guy in the amateur tournaments, he likes to rub your face in the mat, just like he's trying to do to Randy Barber right there. Likes to antagonize his opponent, intimidate, and hurt him as much as he can, and then beat him. Completely humiliate the man, which Buzz is very well capable of doing. And like you said, he's offensive in every way imaginable.
No question about that. He takes on all of the characteristics, and I wouldn't be a bit surprised if that's where he picked up his name of Mad Dog. But he has all of the characteristics of a classic pit bull who has trained for one thing, and I can't help but feel that a lot of it is instinctive with Buzz Sawyer. And for the lovers of pit bulls, I am not demeaning a pit bull. I am merely trying to put out a parallel as to this man's just complete 125% intensity.
Well, that's right, Gordon. Like I said earlier, I may not like the man. I may not agree with everything he does in the ring, but you've got to give the man credit where credit is due. He works out hard. He wrestles hard. Every time he steps in that ring, it's action, Gordon. Action all the way. It may not be too good for his opponent, but Buzz Sawyer, he has a system. He has a style of wrestling. Tommy Rich has a system. He has a style of wrestling. Butch Reed, he has a system, and he has a style of wrestling. And I think Paul Orndorff the same way. When you put these together, two machines like this, well-conditioned, well-trained athletes, such as maybe a Tommy Rich and Buzz Sawyer together, you never can tell what will happen, Gordon.
That's certainly true. Then I noticed.
I hate to disagree with you, Mr. Pritchard, but I can tell what will happen. I tell you, if you take two great wrestlers and you put them in the ring, like an Orndorff and a Koloff, or a Sawyer and a Reed, or a Sawyer and a Rich, or an Ole Anderson and one of those gentlemen, the difference is going to be that they're just too nice. They don't like to hurt anybody. They want to take it easy on everybody. Look at Sawyer here. Look at him. Now, what a move. Now, can you imagine Rich doing that? No. He wants to give a guy an even break. Can you imagine Reed doing it? No. He does. Go ahead. Go ahead.
Well, all I can say is that I have to concur with that. We're going to take a look at that in slow motion once again. And the remarks made by Ole Anderson, I think, are well taken here, because watch Sawyer. Sawyer mounting that very, very top ring rope and a remarkable sense of balance, poised, suddenly exploding off that top, crashes down across the chest, and it is all over for one Randy Barber. There's no question about that. Of controversy right now concerning Tommy Wildfire Rich.
That's right. Tommy Wildfire Rich, I throw fire to your body. I burn you in your own country, United States. Because we invite you to Tehran, Iran, you didn't have a guts. Now I'm your backyard, you American pig.
Well, I don't care to get into his political machinations right now, but let's do talk to Ivan Koloff, the Russian Bear.
Yeah, I got Orndorff right where I want him. Angry, hurt, and Paul Orndorff. I thought you got you in a Russian chain match. This is my type of match. I've never lost at this type of match before, Paul Orndorff. More experience, and you've fallen right into my trap. I'm going to get such great pleasure in beating your body, so you cannot get up anymore, American. And then I'm going to take extra great pleasure stomping your face into the mat and dragging that belt from around your waist and taking it back to Russia with me.
Indeed. Well, the comments from one Ivan Koloff, the Russian Bear. Let's take a moment now to take a look at where some matches will be held, including New Year's Day night. That'll be in Knoxville, Tennessee at the Civic Coliseum. Also, Sunday, January 2nd in Augusta, Georgia at the Civic Center. Match time there is 8 p.m. Monday, January 3rd in Cleveland, Tennessee at the Northeast Cleveland Recreation Center. On Tuesday, January 4th, Anniston, Alabama at the City Auditorium. On Thursday, January 6th in Jasper, Georgia at the high school.
Thursday. I don't care about Friday. We're talking about a cage match. We're talking about everybody in the world watching. We're talking about thinking of me like a mad dog, like a crazy person inside this cage.
At the Omni Christmas Day.
Taking that title away from you.
One fall, television time remaining now. The National Tag Team Champions, the Samoans, going up against Hamilton and Mullins. Hamilton and Mullins. That's Hamilton moving out first. Hamilton. Now the Samoans just explode on a person. Caught him coming off the ropes and then just began to punish him. The Samoans wrestle barefooted and they have extremely powerful legs and use them in a match consistently. Hamilton would like to get back to his feet, and he is now and again taking off his feet.
just thinking. Is there going to be an arena? Is there going to be a ring strong enough to hold Ole Anderson, Stan Hansen, and the Simones?
An interesting point that I was thinking about earlier, of course, in battle royals, many times you have extra men, but many times the ring is also built with extra supports. But you're talking about the intensity, the concentrated energy of these four men, and you're exactly right. You've got a valid point.
You know, Gordon, like, I know Ole's capabilities, I know Stan's capabilities, and there's no sense in you standing here and lie about it. I'm not going to say that I don't know these people. I've known these people for a couple of years. I've watched them wrestle. I've watched them hurt people. I've watched them go through the whole thing. But then, Gordon, when you stand out here on worldwide TV and say you got the best, in order to prove it, you got to go back. You got to beat the best. I feel Stan Hansen and Ole Anderson as good a tag team as any other tag team in the world, with the exception of my team. I have the better team.
Well, you have contended this all along, and of course, at the moment, they are the national tag team champions, so until such time as they are beaten, they have to be indeed considered the very best. Mullins just caught by the Samoan, and again, even more punishment being meted out.
You know, like, you never hear me talk about hurting people. You always hear me talk about beating people. And that I'm aware that Stan Hansen loved to hurt people. He have hurt people. I've watched him do it. I'm aware of Ole. You know, Ole gets off on hurting people, and he brags about it. So I know all these things. So now, Gordon, with me having that much knowledge of those two people, do you think for 5 minutes that I'll stand here and lie to you and tell you that I have no intention of hurting Stan Hansen or Ole Anderson? Because, Gordon Soley, it will definitely happen.
Speak up a little bit, King. I'd like to hear what you got to say, you and your soft little mouth there. You know, he doesn't fool anybody, Gordon. You know, Ole and I, he can brag and he can do all this and try to soothe us all. Don't go anywhere, King. Go on. Say something. I got something. I'm here to listen. I'm here to listen.
And I said that I respect you and I respect Ole. And I told Gordon about our tour together in Japan. I've watched you go to the Japanese restaurant. I've admitted all that. I'm not lying about anything out here. But what I am saying, Stan, I think you and Ole is a great team. No doubt about it. You are a great team. And I think both you guys are great. But what I'm saying is that I have the better team. That's all I'm saying.
Well, that remains to be seen. I think Ole and I, of course, are the best team. That's why we're together. And first of all, you getting over here trying to put everybody to sleep like a snake, trying to get us to, you know, get off our defensive, and then you're going to go in for the kill. Well, you know, we aren't two rookies. We know we've been around, and we know what's going on, King. So we aren't your average guy. Ole and I have been the national tag team champions, and we know what's going on, so we're here to watch.
I think you guys are the two toughest guys in wrestling. I've said that over and over again. Stan Hansen, what I'm saying is the water is boiling, and somebody's going to get burned. Simple as that.
And you're the one that's going to get burned as far as we're concerned, because Gordon, first of all, Ole and I, he can put us to sleep. He's not fooling us. He's not fooling anybody. Ole Anderson and I have been around a while, like we said. We've been teamed together. We've beaten everybody. And we're ready to get the Samoans or anybody else that wants to get in the ring with us. We never go in overconfident. We're always ready.
Well, there's certainly no question about the mental and physical capabilities of Stan Hansen and Ole Anderson. And I must say that I admire both Sonny King and Stan Hansen for being able to carry on an intelligent conversation here without tempers flaring and things getting out of it. There you have it, the Samoans, and no, sir, did not allow the pin. And again, the Samoans making an object lesson out of the man that they have in the ring at the time.
First of all, Gordon, you know, the Samoans, you just look at them, they're probably one of the hardiest races of people in the world, the island people. They're from American Samoa, you know, they've gone all over the world. Just look at them. You know, we understand what they're all about. They're big and vicious, but Ole and I can be big and vicious, too.
Ooh. And we've got Mullins out, and he has really wrenched his back on this one. Mullins with trying to get back into the ring, but no chance whatsoever.
I tell you something. It's amazing. You know, everybody can be pretty good.
Take him home, will you?
Hey, just hurdled a man right into Anderson, and we've got a Pier 6 going now in the ring. It is Ole Anderson and Stan Hansen exploding on these Samoans. And meanwhile, Mullins is being attended to as he was hurtled right into Stan Hansen and Ole Anderson. And brother, do we have a Pier 6 going now? They're coming at it from all directions, and we're going to have to get some sort of order reestablished here. Down on his shoulder. Koloff with the head scissors had a little extra leverage that time. Outstanding match. Pritchard still trapped in that head scissors. Pritchard slips away from that and goes to a side headlock. Koloff back to his feet. Brother! Pritchard came off of the turnbuckle. Beautiful cross body block and after Koloff once again. You know, so many times it has been said that sometimes people are inspired when they... many people who are playing golf said, well, I like to play with a better golfer than I am because my game improves. Well, certainly I think Pritchard is so tremendously fired up realizing the reputation and the skill and ability of this man, Koloff, that he may be going just a little over his head, but by the same token, I'm sure it's giving him newfound confidence in his own capabilities because he has certainly carried the fight to Ivan Koloff. Good drop kick that has Koloff back to the canvas again. Koloff tried to turn that to his own advantage, and that's where being a ring veteran pays off. Want to thank the folks at the local 7-Eleven Union Hall up in Mansfield, Ohio for the nice letter. We certainly appreciated hearing from all of them. Brad Armstrong, who worked out with Paul Orndorff at the very onset of our program, has joined me, and I know you're watching this match with a great deal of interest.
Exactly right. You know, Tom Pritchard's a very close friend of mine. I've wrestled him a couple of times, and I've wrestled Ivan Koloff, and I know that both these men are very tough athletes. And right now, Mr. Koloff has taken over on Pritchard a little bit, but what I'd like to say is that, like you said, I did work out with Paul Orndorff, and he broke out of that cobra hole like it was nothing, brother, and I know I don't have the arms of the superstar, but I'm telling you, I think he's going to beat this man. I really think he may have just the thing to beat, to break that cobra hole.
Pritchard caught that time by Koloff, and it's Pritchard in trouble now as he caught him in the eye, and it is Pritchard up into those ropes, and Pritchard has certainly given a tremendous accounting for himself, but he's got some problems now, Brad.
Exactly right, and that's a backbreaker right there, and that's enough to cross anybody's running lights. But Pritchard come out of it pretty good there. He's got a lot of fire, boy. This guy's got a... Look at it, there it is, right there. Hooked him up the top. Beautiful.
Inside cradle, but Koloff with those powerful legs able to break out of it. Pritchard hurtled outside the ring, and Koloff moving right outside after Pritchard caught him beautifully. And wait a minute, Koloff has grabbed that chain. Koloff grabbed that chain and Brad Armstrong caught him. Brad Armstrong caught him. And it is Brad Armstrong battling it out with Ivan Koloff, and Koloff down again. And the referee has stopped it. The referee has stopped the match, understandably so, in the ring.
Funny to see somebody out here with a Buzz Sawyer's not a basketball. You're going to have to stop him. Take a look. You'll see what kind of man you'll be going against very shortly since we're watching the clock.
Well, we are indeed watching that clock, and Buzz Sawyer, who has to be more than somewhat unnerved by everything else, and brother, is he taking it out on this man, Starbuck. He is really punishing him up against those ring ropes. But again, that's not a Hacksaw Reed either.
Well, no, it isn't. I'd get more enjoyment if it was Hacksaw Reed. I don't think there's much difference. Hacksaw Reed might have a few more muscles, but let me tell you, when you know how to wrestle like Sawyer does, all those muscles in the world aren't going to help you. Remember this. Talking about Johnny Rich and Tommy Rich and maybe even Hog Jaws Hansen hanging around. You better remember, I'm going to be there. And that razor really doesn't care whose hair it takes. It can go for Rich, it can go for Reed, and it can even go for Hog Jaws if we can get that 10-gallon hat taken off that fat head of his. Look at Sawyer. Look at him. Reed, I want you to look at him. Rich, I want you to look at him. You're celebrating Christmas just a little bit early.
Well, of course, we're seeing this view right now, Mr. Sawyer, unobstructed. However, when he does step into the ring with Hacksaw Butch Reed, there will be a steel cage surrounding it, so regardless of who is near that ring, nobody's going to be able to get in and help Mr. Sawyer.
There's no doubt about it, and Buzz can wrestle, but you know he's going to have to be fighting. I don't think Butch is going to come in there to wrestle him tonight. He's going to be in there to fight. He's going to be in a cage. He's going to be in there, and nobody can get in, and nobody can get out.
Let me tell you something. You know, Green Bay was a great football team, but without Vince Lombardi, what did they have? Alabama, great football teams, but they were made that way by Bear Bryant. Well, Buzz Sawyer is a great wrestler, and he's going to be made even greater when Ole Anderson is standing down there ringside. With me on the other side of that fence, I'm going to make that guy be five times better than he is without me, and he's great without me. Now, you can't say that for Reed. You can't say that for Rich. You can't say that for Hanson. I'm going to coach that guy to victory when I get done. I'm going to be doing the shaving.
Now, those are some positive statements from one Ole Anderson, and you could hear Anderson saying, bring him back up. He didn't want to let him have the pinfall of that foul power slam. Brother, you talk about a power slam. He put it in on him. We'll take a look at that in slow motion, and we'll see exactly what we're talking about here. Watch the complete total control that Sawyer has. Brings this man up, and remarkable body control here into a full power slam, and that spells the end for one Mike Starbuck, no question about that. I'd like to remind you, of course, that we'll be wrestling in Knoxville at the Civic Coliseum on New Year's Day night. Also January 2nd in Augusta, Georgia at the Civic Center, and Monday, January 3rd in Cleveland, Tennessee at the Northeast Cleveland Recreation Center. Tonight
right
at the Omni.
Right now, tonight, it all starts. I'm going to be down there. I'll be watching him. He's right outside that fence. Reed, you get yourself ready, because I'm bringing the meanest and the most nasty man in wrestling.
That's right. I got my main man here. Let me tell you something, Reed. You got to beat me first, so there's going to be a lot of disappointed people in just a few hours. And don't forget another thing, buddy. Those Sears and that shaving tree and all that stuff's gonna be out there. So we just might take that and shave your head, because nobody's gonna do that to me.
Well, we'll find out tonight. It's going to be quite a night of competition at the Omni. Plenty of good seating is still available, so make your plans to be there. Match time at the Omni tonight for the Christmas Spectacular is 8 p.m. Iron Sheik faces Tommy Rich.
That's right, Mr. Sony. I burned him. I fought your own fire to his body. I embarrassed him his own country. Now, still I'm not done. In the Omni, Tommy Rich, you're going to get more. You're going to find out about the Sheik.
And, of course, Ivan Koloff goes up against Paul Orndorff, a Russian chain.
You know, it's as simple as this, Paul Orndorff. You coward American. I got you where I want you, whether it's in Columbus, Huntington, Cincinnati, the Omni. That's right. Richard Chainmatch. I can do anything to you. I want. And I'm going to take the national title.
Okay, that wouldn't do you good to tell you.
You're right. You're certainly very accurate in that last statement. Let's go to the ring. We're getting set to go into action now. Superstar facing Mike Starbuck. One fall, 10-minute time limit. The superstar, one of the most powerful competitors that professional wrestling has to offer. But I don't care how powerful you are, you still have to have the leverage, you still have to have the knowledge, and you have to be able to apply the hold.
There's a lot of big guys, Gordon, that think they can just get in there and wrestle, just think they can get in the ring and become a big star. It takes quite a lot of hard work and a lot of ability to get in there, especially when you're big. And as big as a superstar is, he moves with quite a lot of agility and finesse in the ring, I think, Gordon.
He certainly does indeed, but right now he is pretty well got Starbuck in trouble here. Double rear chin lock keeps Starbuck in the red trunks on the canvas. And the superstar, of course, utilizes very effectively a hold called the Japanese Cobra, but he is remarkably versatile and has a number of ways of pinning or making an opponent submit.
You know, Gordon, I think that a lot of people may not like the superstar, may not agree with a lot of things they say, but I haven't really met a person yet who doesn't have the respect for him. A lot of professional wrestlers go in that ring and they just go out there for one purpose and any way they can. The superstar has a method about what he does and the way he goes about it, and I haven't met a wrestler yet who doesn't respect the man. They may not like him personally, but they have quite a lot of respect for him, and that says quite a lot for his ability in the ring.
It does indeed. You notice he is one of the most efficient competitors I've ever seen. There's just no wasted motion whatsoever. The man is cold and precisely accurate in everything he does.
Everything, Gordon. Everything's very deliberate, and he knows where he wants to go next. He knows what he wants to do, and he knows how to position his man just for the right hold and right power move whenever he wants it. Gordon, he's in control constantly in the ring.
Certainly no question about that, and we're seeing a classic example of it right now as he has kept Starbuck in trouble. And Nick Patrick, the referee, spotted that infraction and very quickly called for the break. That's the thing about Nick Patrick that I admire so much, is that he moves in on infractions very, very swiftly. But Starbuck literally booted out of the ring, and the superstar moves out after him again, catches him on the back of the head with a flat of the foot. And again, Starbuck, another percussion to the head. Starbuck trying to get it together now. As he does, the superstar again drives him to the concrete. And so the superstar standing supreme at this moment. And the superstar after Starbuck again. And this time hurdles Starbuck into the ring so that he can move in against him. Rudder drove that knee into him and Starbuck went down. Double thrust into the throat by the superstar, and Starbuck to the canvas. Didn't allow the pin, and again, the superstar obviously trying to make an object lesson out of Starbuck.
Well, you know, I think superstar knows just how far he can go within the rules. Nick Patrick's been warning him a number of times right there, but he knows just how far he can go, and he wants to make an impression on people that he is back. He wants everybody in the country and all over the area to know he's back, and he's back to do some business here, Gordon.
And he just proved his point with a neck breaker. And again, did not allow the pin. And the words of Tom Pritchard ring so true right at this particular moment. Yes, the superstar wanting everybody to understand that he is back. A Russian leg sweep. And either one of those two, the neck breaker or that Russian leg sweep, either one of them enough to put an opponent down for the pin. But again, he's not satisfied using the lariat, if you will. Hollow the arm, and then there he goes for the Japanese Cobra. He has him in the Japanese Cobra, and that means that that arm is coming down across the carotid artery and cutting off that circulation, and Starbuck going to Knoxville right now. And so the superstar has very soundly and very roundly defeated another opponent. Fall, 10-minute time limit. The superstar recently returned from a highly successful tour of the Orient. And here's a man that, well, I've said it before and I'll say it again. Here's a man that has absolutely no wasted motion in the ring whatsoever. He does not expend unnecessary energy.
Not at all, Gordon. I think this is what makes him so popular overseas and around the country. When I say popular, I mean he's maybe not popular with the fans, but at the same time, he is. People respect him. People know he has the ability, and you just take a look at him. Take a look at his body. You can tell the hard hours he spends in the gym, and he's very, very successful overseas, not only in Japan, but Australia, Germany, and many other different countries. And this is why. He doesn't waste any bit of energy, or doesn't waste one bit of muscle on his body.
McKenzie just found that out as he was jammed into that far turnbuckle, and Superstar jams him into the near turnbuckle now. And he cuts through his opposition like a laser beam, and gets right down to the business of inflicting pain and teaching the other man just exactly who the better man is in the ring. However, there's still the shortest time in the world has to be when your shoulders are on that mat and you hear that first count.
Well, you know, you can get a three count. You're right. It just takes 3 seconds. And the superstar, he has a method of going about how he wants to beat his opponent. He might just want to get in there and demonstrate to some of the other wrestlers in the area that he can be cruel, he can be vicious, and he gets in there and he does just that. Whether I think he's trying to impress everybody who's watching the program. He wants them to know when they step in the ring against the superstar, they're going to step in the ring against a guy who's not going to stop.
And he has not stopped since he has entered the ring. McKenzie has not made the first really effective move against the superstar. He has been completely overwhelmed since the onset of the match, and is trying to get it together, but the superstar has just allowed him no surcease whatsoever. It is from the moment one, from the time that bell sounds, it's the superstar with one intention, and that is deliver as much punishment as efficiently and as quickly as he can. And again, McKenzie jammed into the near turnbuckle. And so McKenzie's start of the new year thus far has not been too auspicious. And it's McKenzie hurtled outside onto the concrete. And the superstar again. Punishes him, drops him an atomic knee drop outside on the concrete. That has to jar the spinal column and create a lot of pain and punishment. Got to have McKenzie a lot of credit, though, because he's not giving up. He's not quitting. He's as gritty as he can be, climbing right, well, and an unfortunate assist into the ring.
Well, then again, Gordon, might have been a mistake to sign the contract, but he did sign the contract to get in the ring with a man, and you do have to give him this much. When you step through those ropes, you're really taking matters in your own hands, whether you defend yourself or not. And it looks like this man hasn't been able to defend himself very much, but then again, he's up against a man who's about 6'4", 270 pounds, and nothing but muscle and nothing but pure wrestling ability. And then again, he has the same ability to be rough and enjoys being rough. So he's pretty much took it upon himself to take the contract, and that's just about what you can say for the man.
Well, that's the price you pay. And of course, again, Tom, as you and I have noted in the past, there are so many people that seem to feel that they could do well if they wanted to step in that ring, but it does take a man with a lot of courage, a lot of determination to get in there and take the punishment that they have to take.
No doubt about it. Anytime you step in the ring against a seasoned veteran or a good professional wrestler, you're right. You're taking matters in your own hands, whether you have that ability or not.
Down on the ropes, and again, the superstar delivering the foot, and then again. Get off this rope. What? Referee Nick Patrick warning him about it, and he finally breaks after the count of three. And McKenzie, driven, finally, literally again, booted from the ring. And the count is on, and he mean it. No, sir. The superstar breaks the count as he comes out on the ring apron. All right. He broke the count again and again. McKenzie, a gutty individual, trying to get back into the ring, and the superstar offering him some unwanted help, I am sure. And the superstar brings a massive forearm across the chest, and it's just a question of how much percussion can this man take before he's finally unable to move anymore.
Well, you know, he doesn't look like he's been able to even defend himself in this match, and Superstar's just taking advantage of him as quick as he can. And, yeah, I think he enjoys it sometimes, Gordon. I really think he just enjoys getting in there and chopping meat and getting somebody in there like this.
Brother, he caught him coming off the ropes, and those legs went high in the air, and there he goes for the Cobra. He goes for the Cobra hold, and there's no way that you can escape that. Once he puts it on, it's over. And as the pressure increases on that carotid artery, and this is something that I might warn all of you youngsters who are watching, don't ever put this Cobra hold or a sleeper hold on any of your friends. It's an extremely dangerous, and it can be lethal. And it is not something to be played with. Leave it to the professionals. It's all over. The superstar has McKenzie out. It'll be his responsibility now to bring him back around. But there you see him. But take a look at this again in slow motion. You'll see what we're talking about. Here's where the superstar sets up his man, catches him with that lariat right across the throat. Look at those legs, weight straight up in the air. And before the man has any chance to recover, he very quickly is in behind him, clamps the Cobra hold down on him, and it is, in fact, all over for one Mr. McKenzie.
Wrestlers come here from all over the world. You know, the most exciting thing about this, for the first time in wrestling history, is that we have a lady that's going to enter the ring with the men. My God, see, this is because Joyce feels she's capable. And even if she's not, the big thing is that she got it in her heart, and she feels she's capable of doing it. Sheik, you have to treat everybody the same. Makes no difference, woman or who. You got to do the same thing to everybody.
Yes, sir. خدمت همه شنوندگان ایرانی عزیز سلام عرض میکنم و موفقیت همه شما را آرزو میکنم.
We're talking about $25,000. I'm the most important person I know. I'm going to start off this year very prosperous. I'm going to go into the Omni. I'm going to walk out with 25,000 big ones.
At the Civic Coliseum, match time is 8:30. And, of course, tomorrow night, 8 p.m. in Augusta, Georgia, at the Civic Center. Monday, that'll be January 3rd in Cleveland, Tennessee, at the Northeast Cleveland Recreation Center at 8 p.m. Tomorrow afternoon, though, 25,000 and the possibility of a woman entry.
Well, an unusual situation, the afternoon at the Omni, 2:30. But I'll tell you, for $25,000, I'd come from any place to be there. $25,000 goes to one man. A two-ring battle royal. You understand this now? One ring here, one ring there. You throw the man out of this ring, he's got another chance because he goes into the next one. If he gets thrown out of that, he's done. The two men that are left, they have to wrestle each other. 25,000 big ones. I tell you what, it's going to look awful good when I take that home, start the new year right.
Well, Ivan Koloff has some other thoughts about that.
You know, $25,000, I'd stick my boot in Ole Anderson's mouth. That's right, there's no friends out there. And that's what I'm after. The American dollar and the national title. I'm not forgetting about it. $5,000.
And a quick takedown on Moore. The Iron Sheik, of course, who wrestled for Iran in the Olympics. And brother, a high backdrop, and Moore coming up, and the Sheik right after him. And the Sheik again just continually closes in on his man. And Moore would like to get it together, but has no opportunity.
You know, I think it's evident in all of Sonny King's men. He's going to keep on their opponents. He's going to beat them down, and he's going to make sure that they feel some pain when they're in the ring.
See something rather interesting. Sonny King coming out here with the Iron Sheik, and am I to draw any inference from the fact that Ivan Koloff is the Sheik's partner?
Well, no, I think what happened here, Garden, is that Ivan needed a partner for a couple of matches, and actually he wanted somebody that was qualified, somebody he felt that he could trust and not worry about them turning on him when the heat got tough on him, and he chose the Sheik, which is one of the better people in the world that he could have found for a partner.
In other words, then we don't have to be concerned over whether or not you may be trying
to reveal any information to you whatsoever, Garden, solely, because all you're going to do is gather as much information you could possibly get. You're going to pass it on to Bruce Reed, Paul Orndorff, Santana. We know who your favorite people is, Garden. You know, we sit down and we listen to you, and we know how biased you are. I mean, these guys come out on your program and bring all kind of stuff. Nothing happened to them. We don't hear talk about the commission. We don't hear talk about anybody being fined. But as soon as we do something, everything happened. Right away, there's a fine on Koloff. It's a fine on the Sheik. It's a fine on the Samoans. It's a fine on Ole Anderson. Every time something happens, a little bit, and it doesn't go the way that you people feel it should go, then for some reason, we become the fall guy for you people. So we're not revealing any information to you whatsoever. Whatever we're doing it, Garden, and we're doing it well.
All right, thank you very much, Mr. Sonny King. Interestingly, if I were that biased, it's strange that I would allow him that opportunity to tell the world about it. But Koloff very definitely dominating the situation here with Jim Brown. And now Koloff and the Sheik in a little bit of double teaming, and Brown in trouble here in the corner. And the Sheik has made the tag and now gets set to move out. Koloff, and then you have, there you can see Sonny King, and a rare display of anger. King is generally a very cool individual, very unemotional.
Well, you know, that might be that his favorite might be a little bit upset right now, Gordon, and that might be very unnerving to him, and he wants things done a little bit more efficient and get the job done right this time, I think. And this might cause him to be a little bit angry, a little bit more talkative than he usually is.
Well, that's an excellent point. Things may not have been going quite as smoothly for him as he had hoped or anticipated. Oof. Brown. And Moore, as he even charges the ring, is caught again. And it is Ivan Koloff, brother. You talk about a tough combination, the Russian and the Iranian. Belly to back to play, and Moore came down on his shoulder. And his entire upper body has been reddened considerably now, and it is Ivan Koloff driving with that knee. He just drives Moore right into the canvas. Well, no question about that. You see a gesture of friendship between Ivan Koloff and the Iron Sheik from Iran. And so the Russian and the Iranian extremely successful, and Brown has just been hurtled from the ring. And it's Koloff continuing to punish his man outside the ring. The referee, Nick Patrick, trying to get them separated and get them away from the ring. And
says I use illegal objects. I break the rules. This is all lies. And now he's intense. He's obsessed with the idea of trying to break my leg. I know. I see what you did out there. But I'm after the national title. You happen to have it, American. I'm going to take it away from you, Orndorff. This is right. I got him where I want him. Orndorff, your ribs are hurt now. I don't know about the rest of your body. I know you're a great athlete. Anybody could beat this superstar. He's got to be a great athlete. But like I said, I've got you where I want you. And when a man is upset and angry, like this Orndorff is, he's bound to make a mistake. And only one mistake is all I need. I will capitalize on it. And I will take him apart. And I will take the national title. Now, he's been foolish enough to accept a rusted chain match with Koloff. I have never lost in this match before. I work out with the chain every day with different techniques of swinging it and hitting on things. And I cannot wait, Paul Ronda. I imagine these objects that I'm hitting on is you. Yes, I will go after your ribs. I will go after your head. I will go after any part of you and every part of you until you are so weakened down that you will be begging Cola to stop. And you will have
I cannot imagine the day that I would ever see Paul Orndorff beg, and particularly from Ivan Koloff. We'll be right back. Ivan Koloff and Buzz Sawyer moving out against Johnny Rich and Randy Barber. One fall, 10-minute time limit. That's Johnny Rich moving out first. And obviously, Johnny Rich has got a score he'd like to settle.
Well, you know, if you remember Buzz Sawyer, he's done a lot to the Rich family, and Johnny Rich, this is his opportunity to get in there with Buzz and get a little bit famous, get things evened out.
Right now, Sawyer giving him a... Wow, did Rich explode one on his jaw that time? You talk about a fiery competitor. Rich goes to one side just in time. Old body slam by Johnny Rich. Those workouts and all are paying off.
No doubt about it. Johnny's looking better and better. And it just shows the big Buzz Sawyer shooting that ring. Buzz doesn't look like he wants too much of Johnny right now. And, Johnny's on top of it. Johnny's on his toes tonight. No doubt about it, Gordon.
Well, you know something, too, is interesting. Sawyer scooted out from that ring. Put him in a steel cage. He won't run anywhere. He'll have nowhere to go.
That's right, and nobody can get in either, Gordon. Nobody can climb through. Nobody can get in. And, beautiful work by Johnny. Looking better and better, Gordon.
High backdrop, and Sawyer almost tagged up to the wrong corner. Caught on the button again by Johnny Rich. Brother, Johnny Rich. You talk about putting out 110% effort. He's putting out 150%. He's got that engine churning. All right, Sawyer makes the tag. Ivan Koloff moves in. And Rich explodes on him again. Sawyer very pleased with himself for being able to get over and tag up. And it's Rich catching Koloff in the abdomen. Trying to get over and make that tag. Rich starts to break it up, and Sawyer starts to come in the ring. Being warned by the referee, Scrappy McGowan. Randy Barber makes the tag, has the side headlock on Ivan Koloff. Then Ole Anderson observing. I noticed that Mr. Sawyer scooted out of that ring pretty swiftly earlier.
Well, I'll tell you what, I think everybody's making a mistake here. I'm listening to Bruce Reed talking about the box he's got for Christmas, and he thinks it's going to be great to have Sawyer upset. I know you and Pritchard here have been talking about it. Everybody says that, what have they got in the box? Another stipulation? Are they trying to make him get out of town? Are they trying to run him out of the place? Well, making Sawyer mad is a big mistake, because he's a better wrestler when he's mad. Look at him. Look at Koloff. The two of them are together like a well-oiled machine. Look at that Sawyer. Now, how has being mad affected his ability to wrestle? It's going to backfire on Bruce Reed. It's going to backfire on Tommy Rich. It's going to backfire on Paul Orndorff. Because when we get mad, we just get a lot better.
Interesting comments from Mr. Anderson. Sawyer now punishing Randy Barber. Has him in a backbreaker over Ivan Koloff's knee. And Mr. Koloff has the situation well under control at this point in time. And Barber, those back muscles being stretched in the wrong direction here. And Johnny Rich, obviously very concerned here, but... again, the tag is made. One has to admit they're a devastating combination.
Well, you know, we've been saying for some time that there isn't anybody any better in a combination, any combination, or in singles. What a move. Now, Pritchard, you're sitting here. You're the one that was talking about how Reed was trying to upset Sawyer psychologically. It really looks like it's working, doesn't it?
Beautiful power slam by...
He's going to be stuck for words, too. because you haven't upset Sawyer where it's going to interfere with his ability to wrestle. You've just made him mad. It's like throwing a little water on the bees. They're going to be a little bit hotter, and they're going to come out and sting you just a little bit more.
Mr. Anderson, if I might just comment on that. I don't mean any disrespect or anything, but that's not Butch Reed in the ring. There's a little bit difference. There's quite, not even comparison. Butch Reed, I believe, is about 6'2", 260 pounds of solid muscle, and that's quite the difference.
But well, is there anything stopping Butch Reed from coming in there? Is there anything stopping Tommy Rich from coming in there? They're all sitting in the back somewhere. They must have the monitor on. You know, they can't be in the shower all day long. Sometime they must be watching. And when they are, they must be closing one eye because they got a little bit of straightness or whatever, yellow in them.
Well, I just like to say one other thing. Tommy Rich, Paul Orndorff, whatever, they don't have to run in the ring. They don't have to. They let their own do their own fighting.
Look at. They could have beat that kid. They just dumped him out, put him on the outside, and now they're going to go ahead. It's a little war of attrition. Johnny Rich, as good as he might be, as tough as he might be, no one man is going to be able to withstand the onslaught of two. And these guys are doing it legal. Tagging in, tagging out, tagging in. Nothing illegal at all, Gordon.
Well, one has to admit that they have been tagging in and tagging out, a vertical suplex that time. And it is Sawyer drilling a knee into the chest.
And right now, even if Rich or those other people are looking, legitimately, there's nothing they can do about it because everything is above board, Gordon and Mr. Pritchard, all due respect.
Well, they are tagging in and out. There's no question about it. So Johnny Rich, who is choosing to battle on his own, and may I just say this, has tremendous intestinal fortitude, has taken a lot of punishment, is still gamely fighting, and brother, he has taken enough percussions to the chest to wipe out those ribs. He moved out of it again, and you talk about a man made of iron. We've got it in Johnny Rich, and the tag was made, and it's Buzz Sawyer back in there, and Johnny Rich cannot withstand this onslaught forever, and how he powered out of that, I'll never know. Brother, you talk about courage. This man, Johnny Rich, has got all kinds of courage, tremendous fighting heart, but it's got to catch up to him. He cannot continue to take this kind of punishment. Rich hurtled into that far turnbuckle again. Koloff continues to punish him, and it is Buzz Sawyer moving outside the ring, and I've got to give him
out. Watch out, and goodbye to Mr. Wait a minute!
At the Civic Center, 8 o'clock, but tomorrow afternoon, 2:30, the Iron Sheik's one of those competitors for $25,000.
That's right, Freddy. خدمت همه شنوندگان ایرانی عزیز سلام عرض میکنم و موفقیت همه شما را آرزو میکنم. همه دلار به شما همه کشتی گرفتن نشون میدم.
Two opponents now getting set, Mackenzie and Barber getting set to go up against the superstar and the super destroyer. And there you see them, two men very similar in height and weight and build. Both men outstanding athletes, but they're facing a tough pair here. And very quickly moves in, a single leg pickup. And the thing about the superstar and the super destroyers, they will go to the basics. They rely upon they're heavily on their amateur background. But both of them at about 270, 275 pounds apiece, probably one of the biggest tag team combinations in the country today.
I think this is what helps them very much in the ring, Gordon, if they do rely on the basics. They do wrestle. They do get in there and resort to some of the amateur moves and amateur background that they both have. And this helps them. They don't just get in there and try and brawl their way in, although they're very capable of doing that. They get in there and they demonstrate wrestling. They know what they're doing in the ring at all times. They like to keep control. And it's very hard to tell them apart a lot of times, too, Gordon. Both of these men, they have about the same stature and almost the same style at times. It's really hard to know who you're wrestling unless you've wrestled them a number of times.
You know, it's interesting, too, that the superstar has been given credit, and something that I find absolutely amazing, he has been given credit of slamming Andre the Giant, the eighth wonder of the world. And that to me is, when you stop to think about the kind of strength and leverage and capability you would have to do something like that to Andre the Giant, it's phenomenal. There's no question.
Well, when you're going to slam a 7 foot four or 500 man, it definitely is. And you've got to give the superstar credit where credit is due. The man to slam someone like Andre the Giant, he's got a lot on the ball. He trains hard daily in the gym, and he's a very, very tough competitor. He keeps coming at you, and I don't think he's going to be afraid of Andre the Giant or Stan Hansen or Tito Santana, although I think it'll be some very good competition and very interesting to see how they're going to handle it.
Should be quite a match indeed. And I might just point out, of course, as we're talking along, I'm still wondering how soon Hacksaw Butch Reed's going to let us know what's in that box, because I'm getting a little antsy. And, of course, we're getting pretty deep here into the program. And I just wonder if Hacksaw is going to make it known to us, as he said he would, and let us know what's in that box.
Well, I just asked Butch a little while ago, and he says he's not ready yet. And when he is ready, he's going to tell everybody, let everybody all over the world know exactly what he has in store. He said it concerns both Sawyer, and Johnny and Tommy Rich also have something to do with it, so I guess we'll just have to wait and see, Gordon.
Yeah, it's his play. He's the dealer right now, and we'll just have to wait to see what does come forth, but it's got my curiosity up, and I know it must have yours up at home as well, so believe me, we're making every effort we can, and just as quickly as we can get a Hacksaw out here to give us the answer on this situation, we certainly will. Barbara in a lot of trouble here now as he's caught in a bear hug, and again, you see the massive forearms. He has got himself a handful of problems. Percussion blows into the thoracic region of the back, but very little effect. They didn't have any authority. The tag is made once again, and as you can see, difficult to distinguish between the superstar and the super destroyer. And as Tom, you pointed out earlier, their tactics oftentimes are very similar, so that it's even more of a problem to tell which one is which.
Well, I think also, Gordon, this is why they get along so well. They have the basic same wrestling strategy, and they pretty well know what each other thinks in the ring. You can tell when you're wrestling them as a team that they're working like clockwork. They're working as a team, constantly thinking, constantly on the move, constantly having each other's next thoughts in mind. And this is what I think. With Kabuki, you never know.
Well, that's for sure. And then, of course, you also... The superstar is the Russian variation, and it's a of the clutch itself, pulling him back, and of course that head and neck taking a lot of punishment. The superstar, of course, uses that cobra so very effectively, which is a hold that comes across that carotid artery, causes unconsciousness, and you see the superstar moving back into the ring on Barber at this particular time, a forearm across the back. Barber finally makes the tag, and is able to tag up McKenzie, trying to battle it out with him now, dropped by the superstar. By the way, here's a man who also has his master's degree. Highly intelligent competitor, used much like Stan Hansen used the lariat on McKenzie coming off the ropes. Now makes the tag with the Super Destroyer once again, and it looks to me like they might have had McKenzie at that point in time, but now they're just trying to dish out a little more punishment. There's a full power slam back to the canvas again, the count of three, and so the superstar and the Super Destroyer.
Let me give you a quick preview of what you can expect
for the National Heavyweight Championship. Dorndorf says he has a bit of a surprise for Mr. Koloff. And Mr. Koloff obviously has a surprise for Mike Jackson, as he is moving very effectively against him.
That's right. Koloff's won that title worse than anybody I've seen. No, he's been willing to do anything, that's including using that knee. It hadn't been proven, but I know for a fact I've seen it myself, Gordon, but it just hadn't been proven through the commission yet.
When we have seen a couple of times on videotape the effect that he has had with that knee, and it obviously could not be just a normal knee, that's for sure. And it is Koloff taking some extra leverage that time and being warned by the referee, Nick Patrick. And Nick is a tough official, there's no question about that. Full arm drag and twist now by Koloff. Nice. nice reversal by Mike Jackson and Jackson to a top wrist lock, Koloff back leg trip, and front face lock on Jackson. Jackson escapes from that once again. Good spin under takedown, but Koloff gets the head scissors. And we're seeing some good counter wrestling.
That's right, Gordon. You know, Ivan Koloff has plenty of experience. He knows more moves than probably any other wrestler around, and he puts them into effect very well.
Really, no question about that, and you can tell, obviously, that Mike Jackson is the favorite with the crowd here at the Television Sports Arena. Closes in once again. Collar and elbow has Mike Jackson into the near turnbuckle. A forearm across the chest and an arm whip into the opposite turnbuckle. Jackson, with the speed of a whippet, ducks to one side and could have Koloff in trouble. Good high hip toss and Jackson to the air. Beautiful head scissors, flying head scissors by Mike Jackson. A risky thing to do. Ooh, Jackson. Indicating a clean break, but Koloff wasted no time in closing in on that. Jackson slips to one side again, and he has been using his speed very effectively.
That's right. That Mike Jackson is very quick, and that speed comes in handy a lot out there, Gordon.
And again, Koloff being warned by the referee, Nick Patrick. Rips across the eyes of Mike Jackson and then drives the knee into the lumbar section of the back and caught him with an elbow coming off the ropes, and Jackson trying to get it together. And Koloff again closes in on him. I said, of course, later on in the program, we'll be hearing from the World Heavyweight Champion Ric Flair. Big Bruiser Brody is scheduled to wrestle later on. Jackson hurtled from the ring. And as he did, you might have been able to hear the exclamation of pain as he hit that concrete. And he is coming up very, very slowly, and Koloff moving out against him. Hip toss right on the concrete, and I don't know if Jackson is going to get up. The crowd picking up the chant, "We want Paul, we want Paul." And obviously they're referring to the national heavyweight champion, Paul Orndorff. Jackson having a lot of problems now. The count is on him. Well, the count is broken. I'm amazed that Jackson's even on his feet.
That's true, Gord. You know, you take... Get up in there 5 foot and come down on your back on this concrete floor, Gordon, and I'll tell you what, you feel the pain.
And Koloff very quickly adding more punishment and drove to the midsection. And I don't know how much more punishment Jackson can take. He is amazingly resilient because, brother, this man Koloff has laid it all on him. And this man is absolutely amazing. Brother, you talk about a game competitor. That time Jackson drilled into the turnbuckle, and again Koloff adds more punishment to him. And Mike Jackson, who has just taken tremendous pain, tremendous punishment. Koloff in behind him now, drives him to the mat. That knee right between the shoulder blades and catches him across the chest, gets the count of three. It is all over. It is all over for Mike Jackson.
Only everybody's talking about embarrassing Bud Sawyer. Everybody's talking about doing something about Sawyer. Well, let me tell you something. You gotta knock me down. You gotta kill me before you take this off. They're talking about Williams in West Virginia. Are they gonna get the job there? They're talking about Petrina Hank in West Virginia. Are they gonna gonna get it down to all around the world. People's talking about doing something to Buzz Sawyer. I don't see him doing it in Marion, Ohio. I don't see him doing it nowhere.
Springfield, Williamson, Huntington, Clarksburg, Wheeling, get ready, we're coming.
Action Wrestling will be returning to the Omni on the 23rd.
This is right, the Omni. Huntington, you know this Paul Orndorff tried to get Koloff in tag team situation. Tried to get me hurt. I know what this thinking is. But Paul Orndorff, I got you when I want you, American. And I'm going to take the national title away from him. It's just as simple as that. I've got him hurt. I've got him on the run. He's been afraid to sign contract against Koloff. I'm going to take it away from him.
He signed a contract, but I understand there's a little surprise in store for him.
Sorry, 5 months I'm here. I have that Iranian club. I'm going to bring Afton, Huntington, West Virginia, Ohio, Michigan. I want to know who have the guts to convert that $5,000 in the Ohio.
Loaded on Barber and then catches Chick Donovan. And Brody has just gone berserk. Did he clear out that ring in a hurry?
Let me tell you something, Stoney. I haven't got all darn day to waste around here. I sat around for the first match, and I watched. And I sat around for the second match, and I watched. How long? How long do you expect me to sit around? Listen, I'm going to be coming around here for a long, long time. So that means I'm going to be seeing a lot of you. So me and you, we might as well get along from the beginning. For the rest of them, for all of them who aren't going to be on Bruiser Brody's side, and for every stinking, and I mean stinking, wrestler who's got guts enough to put his tights on and get in the ring, I'm telling you right now, it's going to be a real bad 1983.
Believe everything.
Point right now, and I have with me the world heavyweight champion, Ric Flair.
Well, Gordon, as you know, things are going to be a little different in 83, not because the NWA says so, but because I say so. Now I've taken time out of my schedule to fly right into the great state of Florida and sit with you for a few moments so that I can express my feelings about the upcoming year and the challenges of the Tommy Riches and the Paul Orndorffs and the Kerry Von Erichs, the Dusty Rhodes and the Hacksaw Reeds. Now, you know the championship picture better than any man alive. Put that camera over here on Gordon Solly. Put us together. We're both custom made and head to toe. We look real good on camera together. As I started to say, you know the championship picture better than any man alive. And you know what I have to go through day in and day out. Now, we're going to make it very clear. The title doesn't go up unless I say so. Nobody is going to tell Ric Flair what to do anymore. I'm a proven commodity and without a doubt, the greatest champion of all time. So all you contenders out there, and I'm especially talking about you, Hacksaw Reed, you dandy, this isn't going up unless I say so. You understand? So when you and I meet, brother, this isn't going to be there. This is going to be there, brother.
Tony Anderson at ringside. I thought we were going to have a tag match, but apparently one opponent did not show up, so it's Brad Armstrong in a single match against Buzz Sawyer, and you can see Sawyer with that headgear. And so we are still deprived of the opportunity of seeing what Mr. Sawyer looks like with a shaved head, but... most interesting situation.
You know, it's amazing everybody thinks that they're going to get a chance to see Buzz Sawyer get embarrassed. Buzz Sawyer proved to be just a little bit smarter than the Riches and the Reeds and the Orndorffs because he realizes, like I've said many times, the lawyers can work for you and they can work against you. In this case, we found one that can work for us. He's not gonna let anybody show that film because the court has so ordered. And it's all legal, Gordon. That's the beauty of it.
Well, there is a restraining order out against the showing of that particular videotape, saying the rationale, I guess, is undue embarrassment, but nonetheless. It is Sawyer with a forearm that rocks Brad Armstrong. Armstrong, rookie of the year, has got himself a handful of problems here. His brother, I'll say what you want to Sawyer's tough.
You know, look at Brad. Good. Come on, Buzz.
Brad Armstrong and a good spin under. Takedown by Brad Armstrong and a good, strong move by Armstrong. Ole Anderson shouting encouragement now to Buzz Sawyer. And it is a good fireman carry takedown by Brad Armstrong. Drives the knee into the biceps and triceps of Buzz Sawyer. And Sawyer beginning to have a handful of problems here with Brad Armstrong. Brad has got great speed. Tremendous competitor. Second generation wrestler brought up in wrestling. Leapfrog by Sawyer, but it was Armstrong turning the tables on him. Got him in another good spin under takedown. So Paul Orndorff has a football helmet and will be putting it to use. And it is Buzz Sawyer trying to dominate the situation now with Brad Armstrong. Armstrong dazed.
Call it objectively like it should be. Buzz Sawyer is back. Come on, Buzz!
Yeah, Buzz Sawyer is on the canvas momentarily and on the canvas again as Brad Armstrong caught him in a good spin under takedown.
I'll tell you what, a guy's going to have to do a lot more than just get one takedown on Buzz Sawyer. If their objective is to take that headgear off, they're going to have to almost knock Buzz Sawyer senseless. And I don't think anybody can do that.
I will have to admit that is going to be a monumental job for somebody. There's no question about it. And Armstrong staggered and caught with a knee lift to the top of the head. And Sawyer pounding away. Brad Armstrong fires back again. And Ole Anderson becoming even more irate over the situation. Ole Anderson dangerously close now as Sawyer continues to punish Brad Armstrong on those ropes. And Brad Armstrong, his face rubbed into that second ring rope. And those ropes can be extremely rough. Sawyer closing in on him once again. A forearm into the chest. And blocked that time by the referee. And Sawyer driven back by Brad Armstrong. Armstrong exploding the midsection. Armstrong.
And the National Wrestling Alliance from showing that stupid film. And another thing, when Buzz Sawyer's here, you know you're seeing the best. So all you fat overgrown people at home, you better grab hold and hold on to your women and hold on to your men.
We'll be right back. podium.
Mr. Soli, you know better than any announcer in this country. We have here Paul Androff, we have Hack Story, we have another. I wonder why nobody have a guts to convince that $5,000 for that Iranian club.
Well, I don't have an answer for that, very frankly. We're going to see the Iron Sheik in action. He's going to be going into the ring against Randy Barber, and Sonny King, of course, is here with us, so let's turn it to the ring.
You know, guys, I just want to say, the Sheik had carried the clubs to every arena around World Championship Wrestling. We've had people get in, they've tried, but so far no one has been able to do it. And we're talking about bad economy now. Everybody need money, so of course, you know, if somebody out there thought they could do it, they would be somebody by this time they've done it. So I have to believe, same as the Sheik does, that there's nobody within the reach of World Championship Wrestling that think they can do the club, and because nobody came up there. Now, that's the story for you. Everybody asks me, what happened to you now, Sonny King? What happened to you now? The Simones have gone and left you. Ben Garden, I want to drop a load of bricks on you, too, because nobody leaves Sonny King. Nobody leaves Sonny King. Garden Soli, I am now the true representative of the Moondogs. How do you like that?
You mean you made some arrangements and got them? Is that rather shocking and surprising you?
Well, Garden, see, what happened is, when you're talking about having a representative, you want somebody that's going to come down and get right in the trenches with you, that's going to be there where you're able to do something for them at the time when they need you, not having to call you up on the telephone and tell you what's happening, then trying to get it arranged. So then these people saw what was happening with them, and like, I gave them trouble. If they would have had Dylan down here with them at that time, they probably would have, you know, would have gone on and owned the better things themselves over me and the Samoans. Anyway, Garden, I just want to make a long story short. The Samoans are gone, and the Moondogs are here, and big things are going to happen on World Championship Wrestling with the Moondogs, with the guys of me, Garden.
Startling revelation here by Sonny King, and meanwhile, the Iron Sheik now begins to punish Randy Barber. He has had Barber in dire straits since the onset of the match, and lashes out again. Barber, who has taken a lot of percussions into the heart area, the center of the chest, and it is the Sheik forcing him down on those ropes again, and Nick Patrick now forcing the break. The Sheik coming off the ropes. Ooh, brother. About 250 pounds down across the back of Randy Barber, and Barber back to the canvas again. And the Sheik now just punishing Barber. There's no question.
Let me say this. You know, World Championship Wrestling went out in 1982, and I think they brought the best of wrestling around the world to every people that couldn't even come out and see the matches alive. You know, I've gotten a lot of comments from different people around comparing World Championship Wrestling, and they name another wrestling in the area, and they tell me about these people and the other people, and then I ask them, I say, well, which wrestling do you think is the best? Just give me your honest opinion. I don't care whether it's World Championship Wrestling or your wrestling. Which wrestling do you think is the best? Then they back up and they say, well, I must admit, World Championship Wrestling brings the best wrestler. And there have been people like in other towns come down and say, well, I wish the guys would come to our town, you know, Garden. And I, when you get this kind of population, and this kind of viewing audience, you want to stay where the very best is, because then when you walk the streets, you can hold your head up real high and say, I am a part of World Championship Wrestling, and turn heads in airports, Garden. People look at you because they know you're athlete. World Championship Wrestling have some of the best athletes in the world.
Standing abdominal stretch now by the Iron Sheik on Barber, and Barber hanging on tenaciously, but takes even more punishment. Sonny King now moving over to ringside. And the Iron Sheik brings him up a full body slam. Barber smashed into the turnbuckle again. So the Iron Sheik.
Watch the hair.
Barber has given it his very best effort, but he has just been completely overpowered by this man, the Iron Sheik. Barber driven back to the canvas once again. The Iron Sheik now with a bear hug and jams Barber into the turnbuckle once again. And Barber now really beginning to, those knees buckling and... You see, the Sheik is in just phenomenal condition. And Barber has been weakened and all but destroyed by the Sheik at this point in time. And it is King continuing to offer advice. And again, the Sheik drives a boot to the midsection. So Sonny King maneuvered, and I wonder what ramifications there are involved in that. Belly to back supply by the Iron Sheik on Randy Barber. And now the Sheik crashes his entire body across the chest. He has the count of three. He has the count of three. You'll see...
Huntington, West Virginia! Football pass! Blue Sheik! $2,000! And one of my favorite towns in the whole world, Williamson, West Virginia! Mean! We're gonna come down to Williamson, and we're gonna kick a lot of behind down there!
Wrestling in Marietta, Georgia, next Sunday, the 16th at 8 p.m.
A week from tomorrow, Marietta. We're going to be in Marietta. You get ready. Marietta's where it's going to be happening, but I'm ready. Looking forward to being on that tour. I want you people in Williamson to pay attention. Come on down. Let's see what you look like for a change. Marion, Ohio, Springfield, Ohio, Clarksburg, West Virginia, Wheeling, West Virginia, get ready, because we're coming.
You know, this Paul Lorenz come out, and he said he got the surprise for Cola, and he wears a football helmet. How can the NWA allow this? I don't know who he knows. At first, I think the surprise, maybe it's the figure four leg lock. He's going to try to break my leg. But now I see they let him get away with wearing this. Well, you're not going to get away. I did not see this in the contract. He tried to pull something on Cola. My lawyers are looking into this. Paul Orndorff, you're not going to get away with this. In Gainesville, Marietta, or any other place, I'm going to use you for a 100-foot steel.
From World Championship Wrestling, they have been stripped of the National Tag Team Championship. The championship has been held up by World Championship Wrestling. And so we're going to see the Moondogs in action now. There you see Sonny King. Johnny Rich and Mike Jackson facing the Moondogs in this match, one fall, television time remaining. Johnny Rich, who has been on a weight training situation, finding some of that additional strength becoming beneficial to him. Good block by Rich. Fired out with a right hand that backed the Moondog off. Johnny Rich caught in a bear hug now by the Moondog. And, of course, these Moondogs, both of them, at right close to 300 pounds. So you've got a lot of weight and a lot of power in there. Good move by Rich. Up and over his man. Ducks through his leg. Got him, but the Moondog slipped away from that drop kick. And Rich came right back with a spin under takedown. So Rich has remarkable resiliency and found himself almost trapped in that corner. Battled his way out of it. Gets back over, makes the tag with Mike Jackson, and Jackson moves in. Jackson exploding lefts and rights to the head of the Moondog. Jackson ducks away, caught him, crossbody block, beautiful. Jackson one step ahead on that one, wow. That that's where that tremendous strength takes over. You've got to have leverage. You've got to have the skill, the coordination. And the Moondogs now, with that superior strength and weight, beginning to take their toll on Mike Jackson. And Jackson, at this point in time, needs to get over and make the tag with Johnny Rich. And an implacable Sonny King is standing here watching the proceeding.
Yeah, Don, I'm not really satisfied with what I'm looking at here now. These guys' size and the strength that these guys have, they're not really using the way they should, but it's a little polishing up has to be done. It's going to be a little bit changes made, Garden, and the attack is going to be different. I think they should be more vicious than what they are, and I think they should do a little bit more tugging, a little bit more bone stretching, a little bit more cracking, and make the opponent holler a little bit more. I think letting these guys go a little bit too much, they're looking a little bit flashy, and these are some of the things that we're going to work on, and we're going to change it, Garden. If they are dogs, then they're going to be fighting dogs. You know, they're going to be the type of dogs that you go see where the law doesn't allow it, Garden. You got to go in the woods to see like a bunch of pit bulls. You know what I mean? This is the kind of dogs you're going to be. And I'll say in the near future, Garden, these are the things that you're going to see. This kind of stuff you'll never see. This kind of stuff you'll never see. You'll never see it, Garden. Believe me.
Mike Jackson makes the tag and rejuvenated Johnny King out there. Brings him up. 300 pounds into a body slam. The Moondogs tag up, and look at this. Johnny Rich catches him again. And I said, King, forgive me. Johnny Rich. And brother, did he have him up. He took both Moondogs up into full body slams. Now fires to the midsection. Vertical souffle by the Moondog on Johnny Rich. Johnny Rich gave tremendous effort, but now has got himself in some problems now with the Moondogs. And again, that weight and that strength begins to take its toll. And Rich is going to have to find somewhere to get the leverage on these men if he intends to get a pinfall. And now, of course, going after the throat area, cutting off that supply of oxygen. When you do that, of course, the impossible to burn off that lactic acid, and then the energy level goes way down. Brother.
This is the kind of stuff I'm talking about, Garden. This is the kind of stuff I'm talking about. This is what they got to do. They can't let these guys get out of here and make them look like that flying all over national TV. This is the kind of stuff we're going to work on. We're going to correct all these little mistakes that these guys made today and which have been watched and made. It's going to be a different story with the Moondog all together. They are going to be true dogs if they're going to be dogs, Garden. You know, when you get out here on World Championship Wrestling, they got to realize the world is watching. The world is watching. They're not wrestling in some back alley or something. This is where championship wrestling it's all about. It's here. If you're on top here, Garden, you're on top of the world. And if, you know, with me and these guys corner, Garden, they're gonna be on top of the world. But they're gonna come to the people as fighters and attackers. And this is how we're gonna win our match. All this flying all over the place, Garden, this stuff is gonna be stopped. You watch what I tell you.
Comments by Sonny King and Mike Jackson, who missed a drop kick. Did not make that very crucial contact and is now paying the price for it as the Moondogs now planting boots to the back of the ribcage. And Mike Jackson in a lot of trouble. Johnny Rich starts to move in as the Moondogs continue to take extra advantage here. Tag is made once again, and so the Moondogs. And we've heard the comments from Sonny King, and he obviously is in the process of making some changes in the strategy. Jackson brought up again. Full body slam. Moondog going up on that second rope. Crashes down on Jackson and then tags up. And so, Jackson trying to get over to make that tag. Makes the tag. Johnny Rich explodes into the ring. Rich caught him. Beautiful dropkick coming off. That may have been part of the ring. I'll tell you what. There was a lot of... Jackson back in there. He gets a dropkick and gets in for the lateral press. Look at the power of that Moondog. Had him in the air. Mike Jackson moving in with everything he's got. But Jackson tried a cross body block. The Moondog very swiftly moved out of the way. They had Jackson a backbreaker. The Moondog up on that second rope. Caught him and Jackson drilled that time by the second Moondog coming off the ropes after the tag.
The one in the world is talking about my headgear. They're talking about taking it off. They can't take my head off at first. My headgear, you know, first they gotta beat me. Nobody in the whole world has ever defeated Buzz Sawyer. Yeah, and they're trying to take my headgear. Let me tell you something. Keep on trying, because I'm going to promise you it's going to stay on a long, long time, sir.
It's an honor to have with us the NWA World Heavyweight Wrestling Champion, Ric Flair. Welcome aboard.
Well, Gordon, always a pleasure. World Championship Wrestling, one of the finest wrestling programs in the entire world. Viewed probably by more people than any other sporting event in all the United States. Now, I'm out here for a couple different reasons. I know when I walk out here, we never know that we're going to talk about clothes, talk about women, talk about cars, talk about jet airplanes. We never know for sure when the world champion's here exactly what we're going to talk about.
Well, I do have one thing on my mind.
Well, let me just say one thing first. I know what you've got in your mind. I saw you in Florida this week. I know what's on your mind, and I know what's on the mind of all these people out here. But let me say one thing on behalf of a good friend of mine and a tremendous athlete, and I'm talking about Buzz Sawyer, the Mad Dog. Now, I've known Sawyer a long time, and he's a tough piece of work. And I'm telling Orndorff, and I'm telling Tommy Rich, and I'm telling Santana, and I'm telling Reed, and I'm telling anybody else around the wrestling world that's trying to take that helmet off him, you might as well pack it in right now. Because Buzz Sawyer is probably more man from his knees down than most of you guys are in your entire body. Now, we talk about this. Go ahead with your question, Gordon. I know where you're coming from.
Well, the question on everybody's mind is indeed Hacksaw Butch Reed.
Hacksaw Butch Reed, and why everyone all around the country, whether I'm in Chicago, L.A., Atlanta, Tampa, Charlotte, it makes no difference. Everybody says, why aren't you putting up the World Heavyweight Championship? You keep your mouth shut, sweetheart. Why aren't you putting up the World Heavyweight Championship?
No, this I think is important. I think this is important, really.
What do you expect? She's from Atlanta. Now, let me start over again. We're talking about the World Heavyweight Championship. We're talking about why Ric Flair will not put the title up against Bruce Reed and why he won't put it up against a lot of other contenders their first time around. They say now that Ric Flair is going to beat Bruce Reed because he won't beat 100%. He's got no incentive, that he won't come out there with the animal instinct that it takes to beat someone in a World Heavyweight Championship match. So I tell you what I'm going to do, Gordon. I'm a sporting man, and just because I'm not putting up the world title doesn't mean I'm not going to make things right for Bruce Reed. You see, I want Reed in the ring because I want to end this debate as soon as possible. So I tell you what I'm going to do, Gordon Solie. Everybody knows that money... Well, what do we got here? I don't know how much money I got under here. I probably got about $10,000 between checks and cash, and I'm going to take... That's right, look at it one time. This is how the World Heavyweight Champion walks around. Never short. Now, I'm going to take $5,000, and I'm going to give it to you or to the promotion here, anybody that wants to hold it. And I'm saying that Reed cannot beat me. He cannot wrestle me to an hour draw. He can't even get me started. And I'm so sure of it
that I'm going to put up $5,000. You understand that? Now, $5,000, Reed, is probably more money than you saw